Welcome to another episode of Global Conversations webcast. Today, I'm speaking with Camille Dundas. Camille is the co-founder of BuyBlacks.com, an online magazine for Black Canadians, a renowned keynote speaker and racial equity consultant. You know, I've followed Camille's journey for a number of years now, especially with all the work that she's done with BuyBlacks, whether it's on Instagram or back when that other blue site, X site, whatever you want to call it, was on. But her content was very inspirational, and especially for the Black community, either within the GTA or Canadians. And you know, and through her work, she has had those difficult conversations with a lot of organizations, mid and large size companies such as Google, AstraZeneca, and Canada Goose, just to name a few. So, you know, for a number of years now, I've wanted to have Camille as a guest on this webcast, whether it was Urban Equity Chats or, you know, the earlier versions of Global Conversations webcast. And now I have the honor of having Camille here as a guest. So finally, she's here to speak with me about overcoming microaggressions in the workplace, talking about macroaggressions and how do we overcome that? So as I said, so welcome, Camille, and Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year, Andre. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Camille. So let's get into a little bit more detail about who you are as a person and your career journey. Let's let the audience know everything that they should know about you.
Oh, what a big question. Yeah. I always wanted to be a journalist. Anyone who knew me in my family knew that was my trajectory. And so I was pretty, had tunnel vision when it came to that. Mm-hmm. And my family, thankfully, both my parents always supported that vision. My mom would set up my life so that my only responsibility was to read and write. And my dad as well always inspired me to continue doing exactly what it is that I loved. So I didn't have parents that were, you know, you have to be a doctor, a lawyer, et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera. They always encouraged all of us to follow our passion. So I'm so grateful to them for that. I went to Carleton University in the journalism program. Graduated from there, and in my last year found a passion for documentary filmmaking. Graduated, went off to Rwanda for a couple of months where I got to make my first film. Mm-hmm. And that was pretty life-changing. Came back, started what I thought was my dream job right out the gate at the CBC, working in radio and working in television. So I started off on air. Mm-hmm. And quickly realized that it wasn't all that it was promised, or although it was cracked up to me.
Yeah.
It certainly was not going to be a yellow brick road. And I realized that there was a lot more decision-making power behind the scenes instead of in front of the camera. Mm-hmm. So that was in Ottawa, came to Toronto during the recession, had to start all over again after getting laid off with a bunch of other people. Mm-hmm. You may remember those years, Andre.
Yeah,
difficult year that was, 2008. Yeah. Started over literally as an intern, and then started my first business, which was media training and consulting. So I was helping organizations understand the media, understand how to pitch their story to the media. And then I found always love presenting and talking and explaining and teaching, I guess, but it really is what it comes down to. So I did some really awesome events, one of them called The Big Pitch, that helped entrepreneurs understand how to pitch their stories to the media. So I brought producers that I worked with, put them on a panel, and then brought people up from the audience to pitch in 60 seconds. So I love to just getting people to understand, you know, the mystery of the media, and yeah, just break that down and understand what the media is looking for. During that time, also really starting to get a front row seat into the inequities that exist in mainstream media in terms of how our community is covered, the difference in story treatment, the difference in the angles that are taken when it comes to stories within the Black community. Mm-hmm. And I started getting more connected to my community instead of continuing. The way I felt at first was I have to downplay my Blackness as much as possible in order to fit in and in order to succeed. And I did that for a while until I had a wake up call and I was like, you know what? There's two Black people in this newsroom. If one of us isn't pitching stories from our community, then no one is. Mm-hmm. And I started to embrace that. And then even further, when I met my husband and he came up with the awesome idea to start buyblacks.com, it was, he envisioned it first as a business directory, which it still is. And then we came up with the idea to make it into a magazine. And it was just natural for me to take on the editorial side of the business, given my journalistic background. Mm-hmm. And so we've been doing that. We're celebrating, I think it's going to be 12 years in February, next month, wow, of the business. So we're really proud of how we've been able to stick it out all these years.
Yeah.
A completely bootstrapped company with no outside investors. And we've been able to maintain success. So we're very proud of that. Within Buy Blacks, I started getting more outspoken based on my own research and my own experience about Black history in Canada, and questioning, when I was a kid, why was I never taught these things that I'm learning now? Why were these things not in our curriculum? Why were they so hidden? And starting to realize that it's not by accident. It is quite intentional what is served to us in our educational curriculum. And so I started getting more outspoken about that. And one of the first things I did was created a campaign on Buy Blacks called Black History 365, where I had this idea to, for a year, every single day, I posted a Black Canadian historical fact. And every time I thought that I would run out of material, I just found more and more material. Mm-hmm. And I never left my house to find the material. It was all in books and online. So there are so many talented, intelligent, committed Black Canadian historians who have been writing about our history for decades and decades. It's all documented. It's not that it's not out there, but it is not in the mainstream. It is not in our in our school curriculum. And so I started getting asked to speak more and more about this. And then my career as a racial equity consultant snowballed from there, and where I started getting asked to do more work in this area. And that's when now we've come to the Idea Practice, which is a company I founded that brings together seven other consultants to help deliver Canada's first online educational course for corporate Canada on equity, diversity, and inclusion in the workplace.
So you've had a long history and a long journey, you know, and a lot of it I didn't really know about you. I mean, outside of, you know, the one thing that we hopefully talk about is your journey to St. Lucia and what that transpired. So, I mean, I guess that's the one thing that I uniquely know about you. I mean, if you want to touch upon that, or if there's anything else that you think that is unique about you as a person going through this journey, or going through, or basically going through your career, you know, is that something that is unique about you, or what is something that we should know?
Yeah, it was an interesting, I think, having lived in two different places, like having had my upbringing split in half, you know, felt really unfair at the time. But yeah, looking back, I realized what a rich experience it's given me. So I was born in Trinidad, and then my parents moved us to Canada when I was four. Mm-hmm. You know, just like every other immigrant searching for a quote unquote better life. Mm-hmm. My dad was a civil engineer, very, very highly qualified and regarded in Trinidad. There was a recession, and that's why they decided to leave. Mm-hmm. And when he came here, he quickly found, like many other immigrants, it wasn't what was promised, I guess. Yeah. He had difficulty getting his credentials converted. I saw him, you know, go from being a very proud man to feeling belittled, I think. Mm-hmm. And I think that was very difficult for him as a man. Trying to take care of a family of four kids. Mm-hmm. And so we struggled a lot financially. I saw both of my parents go through some very difficult times. As a kid, you know, when you're poor, it's just normal to you, right? Like, you don't realize that you're broke. You just think that these things are just normal. It's only when you look back and you're like, oh, okay, now I realize. And then to have this very different experience when he decided to move us back to St. Lucia, where he is from, that's where he grew up. He got a job with the government and decided to move us all back there. And that was the worst thing that could have happened to us. I was 12 years old, you know, I was your typical, you know, outspoken Canadian 12-year-old. right?
Yeah.
And, you know, I remember my sister and I putting forward, my sister is now a lawyer, so she would always put forward these arguments and cases for things. And bless his heart, he allowed us to believe that we had some type of choice in the matter. And he's like, sure, yes. I remember standing in the kitchen and us presenting our case for why we should not be moved to this country. How dare you take us from our beloved Canada?
Yeah.
And culture shock is an understatement to go from living in Canada to a place like St. Lucia, to a school that is a convent, completely run by nuns and is very, very strict. So it was a difficult transition for me, for sure. But I must say that all of the work ethic I have today, I absolutely gained from that experience. Yeah. And it was, I didn't realize at the time how it poured into my confidence and foundation to grow up in a Black majority country. Because all the people in positions of power, all of our, you know, our doctors, our lawyers, all those people were people who were Black. And it didn't ever make me second guess that I could achieve any of those things. And I think that actually is, you know, a huge difference when I look at people who are socialized in countries that are not Black majority. So it is, when you analyze it, I think it does make a bit of a difference.
Yeah. And well, that's something actually I didn't know about you, whether it's unique or not. I didn't know you were Trini. So So I mean, for me, because I'm half Trini, so but still, like, I didn't realize that, but now I know, so that's something unique that I didn't know, but that was good to hear in your story, especially when it comes to new immigrants from the West Indies coming to Canada and having their livelihoods uprooted, you know, given their experience, given their knowledge and their professions are all taken away from them because of the fact of, you know, you have to have that Canadian experience. And of course, the racism that exists, and gender biases that exist too when it comes to women coming to Canada, especially in the 70s and 80s, right? So, and in the 60s as well. So talking about the workplace itself, you know, the whole premise of this conversation is to start, is to talk specifically about microaggressions and, you know, to a certain extent, macroaggressions. You know, for those who are not EDI professionals, who already know about this and who are still coming to their journey of learning about racial equity and whatnot, can you tell people or let people know what is a microaggression? How does that show on the in place? And also, what are those impacts on those individuals within the workplace itself?
Yeah. So a microaggression is really defined as the sort of subtle acts it could be, you know, actual interactions or verbal put downs. They're little insults that amount to a put down that is based on part of your identity. And the interesting thing is that, yes, while, you know, we've been talking about racial equity, all, you know, quote unquote, marginalized groups can face and do face microaggressions. So we're talking about racialized people, women, people from queer communities, people with disabilities, people with neurodiversities, people of minoritized faiths, and so on and so on. So, you know, it's interesting because I think that we've been socialized to accept that we will elevate some identities over others. And some identities just simply aren't as important, or they don't deserve the respect that other identities do. It's very, it's a painful realization. But I think if we really sat with ourselves, each of us, we'd realize that we have been socialized to believe that and to treat people as such. And we've also been socialized to feel like, oh, you know, these things are just jokes. And, you know, when I think back, you know, to our playground days, I shudder at the types of things that I remember saying, I remember my friends saying, I remember hearing and laughing about, right? And, you know, we're in a time where, you know, words are always changing. Language is always changing. That is the essence of language. Mm-hmm. And it is not so unconscionable or you know, this gargantuan task that some of us are making it out to seem, that we can't change our language, that we can't admit, hey, that word or phrase, okay, fine, that may have been acceptable then, but it's not now. And so let's change it. And so when we think about these slights, right? You think about things like for racialized people, I've heard things like, oh, you know, you aren't like other Black people.
Yeah.
Or, but where are you really from? If I say, you know, I'm from Whitby. At university, if you're going to an Ivy League school or anything like that, they might ask you, oh, like what sport did you play to get into this school? Mm-hmm. Assuming that you didn't get here on your own merit. Yeah. Do all your kids have the same father? Mm-hmm. People from queer communities being asked things like, what did you look like before your transition? Or who's the man in your relationship?
Yeah.
People with disabilities get things like, oh, you know, but you look so normal. Mm-hmm. I would have never known. Or we make jokes about feeling so OCD today or saying, oh, I feel so dyslexic today. Yeah. So lots of, and women, for example, being told, you know, you should smile more. Or when you come back from maternity leave, they ask you, how did you enjoy your time off, your vacation? As if, you know, you're kicking up your feet in Mexico or something.
Yeah, exactly.
So the impact, and it's often been described as, you know, either as death by a thousand cuts or as mosquito bites, right? Mm-hmm. Like you get these little slights or these little bites, you know, over and over. One mosquito bite or one paper cut won't hurt you, won't kill you. But if you get those every day over time, it creates real damage. I'm thinking about a friend of mine. She's also in the racial equity space. Her name is Carlin Purcell. And she talked about a time. She's also from St. Lucia. And and she talks about, she worked for 20 years on Bay Street, right? In banking. And if you know Carlin, she is a very well-appointed woman. She is super stylish, right? Mm-hmm. And always well-dressed. And she talks about a time when she was having a conversation with one of her managers, I believe, and asking about, you know, her growth and you know, promotions and whatnot. And she says how he just basically looked her up and down and said, you know, people who succeed here are very well put together, or some word like that, or like very something like that, something ambiguous that you're like, what? Like, is he talking about my hair? Is he talking about like what is, like, her hair is natural, etc. Right? Yeah. And she also talks about being made fun of for her accent at work, but then also being told, "Oh, you speak so well," as if English is not her first language. Mm-hmm. And the impact that those things had on her is that she kind of became a shell. And she didn't want to raise her hand to speak first. She was afraid of like mispronouncing something and then being made fun of. And these many more things, unresolved microaggressions, started giving her panic attacks.
Yeah.
And she had trouble sleeping at night. And when we look at research, we see that racialized folks, the reaction that we have, we can have actual physical reactions to these things and cause us, to suffer like actually chronic illnesses.
Yeah.
So research shows us there are deep impacts of this, and where we look at, oh, you know, get over it, you should have thick skin, it is the cumulative impact of having these things said to you. What I also want to share with you, Andre, is that we're moving away from these terms, microaggressions, macroaggressions, and moving towards the term acts of exclusion. Because that is really the essence of what these things are. Because nothing could be said to you. But I've found, especially here in the Canadian workplace, there is a particularly unique way that you are just ignored or excluded from things. And it is very intentional when you look at who is excluded and who is included, who gets invited to things and who doesn't get invited to things. And as we know, a workplace is a social arena. And we spend more of our time at work than anywhere else. So when you are systemically excluded from things, it certainly does have an impact. Now, when we talk about the impact on the workplace, it does have an impact on, I want you to think about your mind space, right? When you're at work, you have a finite amount of mental space for your work. And if even half or even a quarter of that mental space is taken up by you thinking about how you're going to respond to these things, thinking about being on guard before you come into work, you think, should I wear this lipstick? Should I put my hair back? Should I not wear my braids today? Should I wear a wig today? Should I not wear, a cultural shirt? Should I not wear whatever? You're making all these decisions because you don't want this attention on you. Mm-hmm. And you're preoccupied with this when you get to work. Think of the amount of brain power that is taking away from you being able to succeed and actually contribute to your team. Yeah. So it is having an impact on that company's bottom line because you are losing value and input from this person because they are now so saddled with all of these interactions. It's also the reason why a lot of Black folks, when surveyed during the pandemic, were the highest respondents for people who absolutely did not want to go back to the workplace. Mm-hmm. They wanted to keep remote because yeah. being remote actually helped to remove a lot of these interactions. Mm-hmm. And Black people are like, I can do without this. You know, like I don't, yeah. I can put this on mute. I can put my camera off and I don't have to deal with these questions and with these awkward interactions.
Yeah. And, you know, there's a couple of things I want to touch upon, especially, you know, number one, as we're talking about different people who have these acts of exclusion being put on them. The one thing that comes to mind that's been a conversation of late has been the intercultural microaggressions, if you will. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's based on colorism. It's based on, you know, class. It's based on all of that. So mm-hmm. what do you say to people when that those acts of inclusion actually happen amongst the same Black folks or same South Asian folks or et cetera? Like, what do you say to that kind of conversation?
Oh, I want us to remember mm-hmm. that the structures of inequity are, and the people who benefit from those structures are the only ones who win mm-hmm. when we are not supporting each other. Mm-hmm. Because all of it, most when we're talking about in between people of color, the root mm-hmm. cause is always colonialism.
Yes.
9 out of 10 times. And mm-hmm. when we fail to study how colonialism and internalized racism, for example, has impacted us, when we ignore these things and brush them off, right? And mm-hmm. and I'm talking about specifically colorism in the Black community. And mm-hmm. colorism is not unique to the Black community. But I can think about, you know, elders in my own family who, you know, I grew up hearing these things, hearing that, oh, you know, you should marry a white man because they'll treat you much better or mm-hmm. your children will have lighter skin. Mm-hmm. These are things that became normalized in our families, particularly in the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. The divide between Caribbean Black people and African Black people is completely manufactured by colonialism.
Yeah. Yeah.
And when we start to buy into that, we are just allowing the structures of racism to win because it keeps us, the whole point of these structures is to keep us apart and to mm-hmm. keep us from looking at the actual problem. Mm-hmm. It's a distraction game, right?
Yeah.
I can, and if you want an example, I interviewed a Black doctor many years ago. She was the head of one of the medical organizations here. And she told me about when she was doing her residency and among a mixed group, I believe, of white and other people of color. And she's I believe she was of African ancestry. And they were doing a project or whatever. And one of the guys in the group started making these clicking noises at her. And first she didn't turn around because she was like, okay, whatever. And then she realized he was doing that at her. And then when she turned around, she's like, what are you doing? And he started laughing and they all started laughing. He said, oh, you know, I'm just trying to talk to you like the pygmies do in Africa. And they all started laughing. And she said she was just left sort of stunned. Mm-hmm. She didn't know how to respond to that, what to mm-hmm. do, whether to report it, whether to talk about it. And most of these times, these things happen to us so fast, so quickly. Yeah. Yeah. We don't respond. And it hurts because then you just keep that in, it festers, and then these things keep happening. And because you have no avenue to talk about it, it just keeps piling up and piling up and piling up. And then when you do respond, you do blow up. Now you're looking like the unreasonable one because everyone's like, whoa, whoa, what's wrong with you? But you've been holding this in for so long. And then it finally just boils over.
Yeah. And, you know, and also going back to another thing that you'd mentioned, and it goes into microaggressions, not, you know, that often go unnoticed and undressed in the workplace. And one of the things you mentioned was about, you know, the remote work aspect of it all. Mm-hmm. A lot of us are returning to work 2 days, 3 days a week. There's some small portion of companies coming back 5 days a week. So if this is unchecked and unnoticed, mm-hmm. you know, there's a lack of productivity there. There's the economics that say this. You know, how are companies supposed to react to this? You know, why are they just ignoring this just for the fact of, you know, having presence or whatnot? So these are things that I still kind of question as to why they would want to do this when they know that there has been impacts on their employees.
Yeah, because it's easier to ignore it. And I'm going to be very transparent because this is what I have seen as a consultant firsthand, that companies rather fire people than deal with interpersonal issues. Mm-hmm. I have been brought into a company where I've been asked to, you know, host a session about, you know, microaggressions or racial equity, and sort of an educational session, but then also been told on the flip side, hey, we're doing this session because X person is being sued by another person in the company, and we have to appear to be doing something about it based on the settlement, but also don't put too much effort into it because X person is going to be fired next month.
Yeah.
And I think to myself, okay, so what we rather do is bring in a consultant like myself to for show, right? And look, we've done this session. And then we're going to just quietly let X person go because we know we're not willing to do the actual work to have the uncomfortable conversations between X person and the Y person that they offended. Mm-hmm. And to do the difficult work of having these multiple conversations of opening up our workplace to try to make it in, to transform it into a place where we normalize talking about these things, where our, so therefore we don't get to a point where one of our employees is suing another, because we have gone through a process where that person, one, feels safe and heard. When someone just goes to the extreme of bringing legal action against a coworker, it's because it's usually because they have had no other recourse. They have not been listened to. They have not felt safe to talk to anyone or that anyone will take them seriously, or they have been harmed over and over and over again, and they really can't take it anymore.
Yeah.
So instead of trying to remedy the conditions that led to this, we rather just quietly get rid of them, move on. That is what I have found as a pattern in Canadian workplaces that I have worked with. We rather just sweep it under the rug.
Yeah. And, you know, but the thing is, what they don't realize when they do this is that there's that cost of rehiring people, you know, training them, etc. Wouldn't it be better just to deal with the situation firsthand, you know, and what about the training side of managers and leaders, right? Correct. Would you rather spend money on them so that you retain talent instead of the cycle of the talent cycle, acquisition, all of that,
exactly,
right? Yep. So these are things that a lot of organizations don't want to deal with, and they'd rather say, okay, we'll just waste the money and hire somebody else, and hopefully they won't give us any trouble. Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, you know, and there's that whole concept of, oh, you know, racialized people, black people, et cetera, are the troublemakers in organizations. And sadly, that is the stereotype that exists. And that is a microaggression that exists in organizations. Correct. Right. And absolutely. This is something, right.
From what the feedback that I've heard from many black employees that I've spoken with is that they do not want to speak up because they know that they will be labeled as the troublemaker, and that will impact the rest of their career. And so you have, when you talked earlier about divides within communities, when I do like a listening session or for black employees, there's always this divide. There's the side, it's usually like sort of the older, more experienced Black folks who've been at the company for a longer period of time. Mm-hmm. And they're like, look, just suck it up, move on, like da 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 da. But then the there's a set that's younger, a little bit more bolder, like, no, we don't have to accept this. Right. And there's some real judgment on both sides, right? That keeps those groups from being able to work together. You have the group that are the apologists, you have the group that are the gatekeepers who don't want more Black people to come into the workplace because they just want to be that only. They want to hold on to that seat. So there are a lot of different components that are happening within groups. So it is something for us to get real about, that sometimes we are also holding ourselves back from being able to gain the equity that we should have had from the beginning.
Yeah, and it's those gatekeepers that I've learned to fully not understand why they do this when you're supposed to be uplifting people of the same color, of the same, even the same class, regardless of color, right? Because if you've grown up the same way, we're going through economic situations that everyone is, with groceries, the housing prices, et cetera, we all have things in common. So why are you holding on to that seat at that table when you know that you've been discriminated against, et cetera. And also in your career, a lot of people say that they just don't do this because they've been burned.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Well, it's internalized because we have been conditioned to believe that there's only room for one good Black person.
Right. Yeah.
Right. That's how we've been taught to look at it. So you coming in as another Black successful, good person, you're a threat to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we need to change that.
Yeah, definitely. And so, as I touched upon it a little bit and we touched upon it a little bit. So, as you go through the training sessions, as you go through this, how do you respond to people when, they say, oh, I don't know how to deal with this, as a manager, or I don't know how to deal with this as a leader of an organization. Meanwhile, they do know what microaggressions or insults or macroaggressions are all about. So in your practice, what are things that you tell these leaders in terms of what they need to do in order to avoid microaggressions within the organizations, within their teams, et cetera?
Yeah. I first encourage them to dive into their own biases and really confront their own biases so they know where they're operating from. And some questions they could ask themselves is, okay, what am I thinking in any situation? What am I thinking? Why am I thinking it? Mm-hmm. Is there a past experience that is impacting my current decision? Is that past experience applicable now? Or is it based on a preference or bias? If this person looked like me, how would I react? Mm-hmm. And I ask them also to have the courage to declare your biases and ask for feedback. So that because biases is what is the basis for these microaggressions. That's where they come from. The microaggression is an expression of the bias.
Yeah.
Right? And so, for example, if you and I, right, Andre, are both hiring managers. And we're going to interview somebody, right? You could tell me, hey, Cam, you know what? I'm just letting you know I have a bias in favor of people from Trinidad. So if I hear a Trini accent, I'm going to want to hire this person on the spot. Just letting you know, I don't care what's on their resume.
Yeah.
I'm just letting you know that's how I'm going to feel, right? Yeah. I'm using a benign example, right?
Right.
But I have heard, and I'm sure you have as well, I have heard biases of all types that will surprise you, right? That people make real life business decisions based on these ridiculous, really is what I can think of, biases, right?
Yeah.
Let's say we're going into that. You can declare that bias to me. I can say, all right, cool, I got you. When, if that comes up, I might say to you, hey, Andre, let's take a second look at this. Do you think you might be, your bias might be coming into place here? Mm-hmm. We've now normalized the fact that both of us have biases. Mm-hmm. We're not pretending like we're going into this, we're all perfect and we're going to follow the rubric and we're going to whatever. Because that never happens. That's not how real life happens. We rarely ever follow the rubric. Okay.
Yeah.
But if we can normalize talking about this, then we can hold each other accountable. I was on a hiring panel once. I was the only person of color on the panel, three other white males. Mm-hmm. And we interviewed this candidate who I assumed was of the Sikh faith. He was wearing a turban. He was. And great candidate. I in my rubric, he ticked all the boxes. I thought he was fantastic. When we walked out, again, we're not supposed to discuss the candidate when we walk out. But of course we do. We're by the elevator. Now we're talking. And I was like, oh yeah, great, great candidate, right? The other guy's like, what, are you kidding? No way. And I'm like, what do you mean? I thought he was fantastic. They're like, come on, look at that guy. Would you want to have a beer with him? And, you know, I was, thankfully, I was already, you know, far along enough in my career that I had the confidence to respond. Because early in my career, I would not have responded. And I just responded saying, well, you know, good thing we're not hiring drinking buddies then, right? Yeah. And it got real uncomfortable and real quiet.
Yeah.
And when people ask me, Camille, how do we respond to these things? This is one of the ways that you can respond with just some type of joke that really it makes it uncomfortable for them, because now they have to think, why did I say that? And why did I think that was okay? Now you're forcing them to reflect, right? As opposed to attacking them and be like, well, you're a racist and you're this and you're that. That rarely ever gets you anywhere. Get them to reflect. Get them to think. Ask them, what do you mean by that? What did I miss here? I don't get it. Explain it to me. And the more they explain, the more they hear themselves, the more they realize, oh yeah, this is not appropriate.
Yeah.
But these are the, when I say a lot of people dismiss microaggressions, you know, but these cumulative effect, right? I have seen real big decisions in the workplace made based upon these biases.
Yeah.
I have seen it. So it does have real life consequences.
Yeah. And, you know, I want to close off by talking about those, you know, those biases and hiring decisions and whatnot. And one of the things that we are now talking about, futuristically speaking, is the role AI plays in this work. Well, there's two parts of this. Is, as we spoke about, was the current situation of how do we deal with microaggressions in the workplace, especially as we're coming back to work, or, you know, work, hybrid workplace, et cetera. The next one is, you know, the future of what the workplace is going to look like, which is, you know, the impacts of AI, implicit bias, racial bias, et cetera, within the language, the language models, as they call it. So, you know, as a racial equity consultant in doing this work, I know this is all new and kind of, we're still learning this, a lot of this, but what are you saying to people who are coming to you and saying, you know, oh, there's, you know, what about the racial bias that exists in these models, in AI, and especially in hiring decisions or testing or whatever? And how can we curb these in the future?
It is, I think, should be one of the most the utmost priorities for us going forward. It is very disheartening now to see the backlash, or white lash, as you could call it, that it is happening, particularly in tech, in terms of the drawback, not drawback, the pushback, pullback rather, on DEI programming. Because as AI becomes more embedded in our lives, it is the more that we need to focus on making it equitable. When I think back to stories I've read of a Black employee who talked about being on a team that was doing voice training for, I won't mention the name, but the automated friends that we have around us, that we use in our cars, in our homes, et cetera, right? And the decision making was about what dialects or languages, et cetera. And this person was Black American, and they were saying, well, we should also include African-American vernacular, AAVE. And their boss was like, that's not our customer. That's not our customer base. We don't need to include that. When, in fact, when you look at purchasing power and you look at studies, Black folks are some of the highest consumers of tech. Problem is, we are highest consumers, not highest producers. But we are some of the highest consumers of technology. When I think about little things, like when I go into any public bathroom, and often I can't get the water on or the dryer to come on with these automated faucets and dryers, because the melanin in my skin is just, it's not picking it up, because these things are not tested on people with melanin. They're often tested on white folks.
Yeah.
And then so when a Black person comes along to try to use it, it doesn't have to like do it two or three times to get it to work, right?
Yeah.
They're all, you know, that's just a little thing, but they're all when we talk about more dangerous things like facial recognition using in policing, you know, I'm sure we've all seen now the study that came to light where the AI couldn't even pick out like Oprah's face from a lineup of other quote unquote criminals. This is having real life impacts, right? And I would urge anyone listening to follow people like Timnit Gebru. There are so many amazing Black women who are leading the way on this and who have been silenced and who are risking their life and careers to continue to speak about this. So it is absolutely important that we double down on equity, particularly when it comes to AI, because it has life or death implications.
And so in closing, I want to, as we talked about the future, you know, what do you think the future of corporate culture is given the persistent challenges of microaggressions and macroaggressions?
I would love to leave you on an inspirational note, Andre, but yeah. I got to keep it real. And I don't see it changing rapidly. Mm-hmm. And as a consultant, you know, as an educator rather in this space, I have fully committed, you know, that to the idea that these things are incremental. The mm-hmm. the success and the change that we'll see will always be incremental, and mm-hmm. we've accepted that to some degree. And so I do see incremental change, but I still see a lot in terms of Canadian corporate culture, a lot of denial, a lot of that's an American problem, mm-hmm. a lot of, you know, I did a keynote in Vancouver earlier this year, and we had sort of anonymous questions going up, and I did 45 minutes talking about microaggressions, sharing my own experiences about them. And one of the questions was, is this really a problem in Canada? Mm. I just did 45 minutes explaining Canadian specific content. I don't use any other examples than my own mm-hmm. and of other Canadians, right? Studies upon studies. Mm-hmm. And that was the question, is this really a problem in Canada? And so we still have this idea of ourselves as, you know, we're better. We don't have this problem here. And it became very heightened after the murder of George Floyd. A lot mm-hmm. of the corporate response was, well, I'm so grateful to be living in Canada. Mm-hmm. And I had to really sit with leaders and explain to them why that was an insult mm-hmm. to their Black employees. When they thought that they were, you know, saying a good thing, it's an insult because it erases the experiences that they have had as a Black person in Canadian corporate world. So there's a lot of re-education that needs to happen. And that is what people like myself and you are committed to doing. It is, I will tell you, you know, before we came on, I was looking at my LinkedIn page and realized that I hadn't posted anything in 2 months. Mm-hmm. And I realized how exhausted I have been with these conversations, mm-hmm. how disappointed I have been with the direction of these conversations. So I'm at a point where, you know, I have to pick myself up and put myself back on the path. But mm-hmm. I can tell you the last 2 or 3 months have been very disheartening to see. So my hope is that people like yourself and me, we will find the resolve to continue, because we know it can have really beautiful results when we do the work.
Definitely. Camille, you know, I just, as I close our conversation, you know, one thing I want to specifically ask, it's kind of a fun little question, is if there was one superpower that you had, what would it be and why?
I always want to fly. I dream of flying at least 3 times a week. Ever since I was a child, I always dreamed of flying. I think it is just probably the most freeing thing that I can think of. And as someone who has felt a lot of, felt caged in a lot in because of many different reasons, I'm not surprised that that's the first thing that comes to my mind, just to have that total, complete sense of freedom.
Yeah, well, that makes a lot of sense, and great way to think, and great way to end this, end our conversation. And so basically, you know, I want to say thank you to, you know, to this conversation, to having this candid conversation on a very important topic that we've talked about incessantly, if you will. And we need to get to that next stage of how do we create equity in the workplace, racial equity, social equity, gender equity, et cetera, et cetera. And this, you've enlightened myself, you've enlightened a lot of people who will be watching and listening to our conversation. And I really thank you, Camille, for your candidness and your, and the education that you bring to the conversation. So thank you for that. And one last, and of course, last thing, where can people find you?
LinkedIn is the easiest place to find me, and I respond to all my messages. If you want to send me a direct email, it's hello@CamilleDundas.com.
Okay. Well, again, thank you for another episode of Global Conversations Webcast. And tune in for our next episode where we'll be having conversations like these, candid, open, and insightful. So thank you, everyone. And Camille, thank you again.
Take care.
All right, take care.